Today, we are going to focus on food stamps, now known as EBT, Electronic Benefits Transfers, and our guest today is a smart young lady by the name of Chapter. She wrote and performed a song titled, It's Free, Swipe Your EBT, available on KatrinaPierson.com as featured on ChaptersWorldTV.com, and I had the pleasure of speaking to Chapter last week, and this young woman impressed me beyond expectation. So, Chapter, thank you very
Hello.
Much for joining us today.
Thank you for having me.
And you are in California, correct?
Yes.
Wonderful. Well, we're happy to have you here. And, you know, after we talked last week, I felt a sense of commonness with you, which is quite rare for me. It is not often that you meet people with similar circumstances throughout childhood and even through adulthood who understand a lot of what you've ultimately decided to do with the knowledge and skills that you have that relates to family, ethical, and moral issues. Maybe we were sisters in another life, but I'm thankful to have connected with you, and I'm honored to get your message out.
Great. Thank you so much for having me. I'm ready.
Wonderful. Well, why don't you just tell the audience a little bit about, you know, who you are, where you came from, and just all of the Chapter.
Okay. I am a singer-songwriter. I am a music video director, and I am a college-educated young lady. I basically use satire in my music. I see myself basically as a living color artist. I talk about topics that people don't want to talk about or afraid to talk about and just refuse to address. So I decided to do it and use music and use a beat and make it clever enough for kids to dance to it and sing to it and have songs in it that they really like, and then have songs in my music that they can learn something and feel something and say, you know what, I don't want to be like that person, without the judgment, but I just don't want to grow up to be like that person in her music video. So I use my experiences as a child to write my music. I tried to write music that I thought people would want to hear and dance to, but it was something that just didn't flow out of me, so therefore I decided to write things that I know about, that I've seen, such as child abuse and neglect and dating older guys and growing up in the ghetto and experiencing a father that was never there for me, who was an inmate my entire life and he's still in prison. I decided to just talk about things that I felt could really, really help the youth and people today.
Well, I think it's fascinating. Let's get into some of those things as we get in the show, for sure. You talked about going to college. Where did you go to school, and what did you study?
I went to Westchester High School. I went to West L.A. College, and I went to Cal State L.A., and I studied child development. And I decided to take that major because I wanted to figure myself out. I felt like it was a lot of things that I would do, and I had no reason behind it. And so I felt child development would be perfect because I could really try to help myself and counsel myself in doing so. So I decided to take child development. In doing that, I really saw my life and things that I didn't want to become. So that's why.
How did you end up in college, though? Considering your circumstances growing up, what made Chapter decide to go to college?
When I was in, my mother never told me to go to college. She never told me to go to college. I decided that I wanted to. I was a special needs child, and it was because I didn't have a mother and a father that took time to educate me, and it was all types of madness in the home. I basically decided that I wanted to go to college in the seventh grade, and I took an IQ test, and the teacher asked, who's Latoya Hicks? And I didn't want to raise my hand because I was like, wow, I probably scored the lowest, and she's probably, you know, going to make fun of me or something. So I raised my hand, and she told me, I expect a lot from you because you scored the highest in the class.
Wow.
And I decided that I could do anything. I passed every grade. I made A's and B's. A's and B's. In high school, I made A's and B's. And I ended up graduating ahead of my class. I flunked the third grade, but I ended up graduating Westchester High School in the right grade that I was supposed to be in and ahead of them.
So when your teacher asked you to raise your hand and you didn't want to, I mean, what was holding you back? There was some type of fear or inadequacy felt. Do you think it was because of your treatment as a child that hindered your emotions at that point?
Yes, I was abused so bad as a child. My whole childhood, it's just memories that I still wake up from in a cold sweat. I was told that I could never do anything, that my dad wasn't anything I could never be. I was so in fear of my mother. I was so in fear of all the boyfriends that she had. I was in fear of my older brother who tortured me my entire childhood. I was taught to not tell anything, to believe what she told me. Fear. I was taught fear. I was taught fear, and it lowered my self-esteem. When I was in special needs classes and the teacher would have to take me out, I had no confidence. I had no self-esteem. I couldn't even read in the third grade. I couldn't hold a sentence because of the abuse and the neglect that my mother put me through. And I truly feel that the welfare system encouraged her to do that. And
I'm glad we have you on the show because what you are talking about is more common than the average person knows. I mean, this is very common of the children, especially the young girls, who grow up in the ghetto, under the system of a redistribution of wealth. You are taught not to say anything. You are taught that you will never be anything. Most of the kids don't even know that this is an alternate way of living in life until they do get older or at least come across one who lives differently. And so that's why I think your story is so important. What was it that made you want to break that cycle and take control of your own life? Did you have an experience, or did you just snap one day and say, I'm taking my life back? What was it? Do you have a point in time where you can pinpoint that decision?
Yes, I would say that, it was a time when my mother told us that this is my house. It was a Section 8 house, and she told us that this is my house. I own this. And growing up, kids really know when their parents are using them for a check. They know. They can feel it. And so I would wake up. I was in high school, and this is when it really snapped for me. I was in high school, and I was getting up. Every morning I would get up and get ready for school. And in doing so, my mother would wake up, and I would see her, like, come out of her room, and I would see a man in the bed with her. It was always a different guy. It was always different shades. It was just always someone different. And I remember feeling like, I don't want to end up like her, because look what she doesn't have anything, although she feels like she has it all. Like, I'm about to graduate from high school, and my younger brother is not too far from me. We're all about to be grown. What will she really have in the end? And so I just decided that I didn't want that. I worked hard in high school. I worked in college. I've always been a worker. And so it's not that she didn't work, though. It was all about games with her. Like, she worked the system. She worked. She did hair. She did, you know, notaries and taxes for people. It was just like, I didn't want to have children. I knew that. But I didn't want to end up like her. Like, I watched her my entire life, game the system, tell her children that they're not anything and that this is my house. And I knew it wasn't her house. I knew the state owned it. I knew that we all went down and applied for Section 8. she would always take us to the county building. I knew that these things were benefits because of us. I just didn't want to end up with nothing. I knew that if I went to college, anything that I wanted, and it was mine, and it couldn't be taken away from me. But with welfare, it can be taken away any day, any time.
But unfortunately, you know, many people don't realize that, and you're absolutely right. You do get to an age to where you recognize that your value to your parents really are nothing but the amount of the check that they're receiving to have you. And that is the culture they have in a state of redistribution of wealth. And, you know, I was 16 when I ran away from home and thought,
wow,
I was going to change my life. So, again, it's a similar, you know, decision that was made right around the same time. And so, and good for you for doing that. But what we're going to do now is we are going to take a break. And when we come back, we're going to talk to Chapter about what inspired her to write this song and produce this video that drummed up a ton of controversy but went viral on the internet. And we will get to that when we come back from a break.
Concord Pharmacies have been serving the greater Atlanta area for over 25 years and has 11 locations in medical building and near hospitals to better serve you. We work closely with your physician to optimize your personal health strategy. Concord has emphasized the utmost importance of the physician-patient-pharmacist relationship. Do not assume because we are not a national chain that we are not competitive. Concord provides competitive pricing and your copay for your prescriptions is the same as at other stores. Concord Pharmacies also provide several services not found at other pharmacies. One, we provide you with hard-to-find medications. Two, Concord prides itself in customized compounding for medications not commercially available. For more information, call 770-671-0657 or go to our website, www.concord-pharmacy.net. Did you